long-distance wedding planning, and your questions answered. That's coming up next on the Wedding Planning Podcast. Why, hello there, and thank you so very much for being here with me today. We are going to review some tips and tricks to keep top of mind if you are planning a wedding that's taking place in a city other than where you live. So I'm calling it long distance wedding planning just in case there was any confusion about that. And the things that we're going to review today are going to also apply if you're planning a shower out of town, a bachelorette party. We can kind of use some of the same principles. Stick around until the second part of the show if you're not planning a long distance wedding, because I also have lots of your great questions to share. Before we get started, I have a fun giveaway. I have 7 Wedding Planning Podcast trucker hats. They are really cute if you like pink. If you don't like pink, then tune out for a couple seconds because they are very, very pink. All you have to do to claim one of these 7 hats is be one of the first 7 people to send me a DM on Instagram. And you can find me at Wedding Planning Podcast. That's all one word. So head over to Instagram, send me a DM. And in that DM, will you please let me know your favorite episodes, your least favorite episodes, and don't worry, I promise I will not have hurt feelings. I just really would love to hear your honest opinion. And also, I will need your name and your mailing address to get you one of these cute hats out in the mail. So again, Wedding Planning Podcast, shoot me a DM with your favorite, your least favorite Wedding Planning Podcast episodes. And if you are one of the first 7 people to get in my inbox, the hat is yours. And with that, let's dive into the first part of our conversation today, which is on planning a wedding in a different city. So there are lots of reasons why this can happen. We move around a lot for school, for work, we relocate. Oftentimes you're from a different city, state, or maybe even country than the person you are marrying, which always throws some trickiness into the equation. Let's review some tips for staying organized and keeping your sanity if you are juggling long-distance wedding planning along with all the other things in life. I know it's a lot. It's definitely an added degree of difficulty. And again, like I mentioned before, the same suggestions will also work for out-of-town bridal showers, bachelorette parties, any other big wedding events that are taking place in another city. So the first thing to consider is, if at all possible, allowing yourselves a longer engagement period. The average engagement is somewhere in the ballpark of 1 year, plus or minus. If you can give yourselves a year, awesome. If you can give yourselves 18 months, that might be even better. This allows you to make 1 or 2 trips back and forth, and depending on the distance, if we're talking about going from one country to another to kind of get these plans to come together, you will likely need a longer period of time in order to make some of those back and forths work. If it's absolutely not possible and you want to hurry up and tie the knot, that's totally fine too. But again, if it's an option, you might want to extend your engagement out by a half a year, giving yourselves more total time. Tip number 2 for planning out of city, state, or country. If it's in your budget, I would highly recommend hiring a wedding planner from the city that you're getting married in. If a full-service wedding planner isn't in the budget, that's no problem. You're going to need to have an airtight group of trusted loved ones, friends, and family to rely on to make this all come together. Trust me, you're definitely going to want boots on the ground in the city where you're planning. So if it's your fiance's family who lives there or is from there, or it's your family, if you have no family in the city you're getting married in, or friends, which, now that I think about it, that doesn't even really make sense, because why would you be getting married there if that were the case? So full service wedding planner is ideal. doesn't even need to be full service. You could hire someone for the last portion of it, the last few months, but you do need somebody there who can pop into appointments for you or maybe give you an opinion on something. That's going to be really hard to do for some things if you are not physically present. And then moving on to tip or suggestion number three, I preach this all the time, but keep things simple if you're planning from a long distance. The fewer moving parts, the better. It's only going to work out to your benefit. So for example, if you're kind of envisioning doing your ceremony in one spot and your reception in another spot, an example of keeping things as simple as possible, can they both take place in the same spot, the ceremony and the reception? This gives you one less site visit to make, one less decision to make, a lot less logistics in terms of getting people from A to B and back. So keep it simple. If things can be held in one spot, that is ideal. And then to kind of carry on with this point, the fewer vendors that you can hire, the better. In my personal opinion, if you're planning from far away, the ideal opportunity for you would be an all-inclusive venue that supplies pretty much everything. So we're talking the decorations, the tables and chairs. They have an on-site planner or coordinator that is yours to rely on. They have in-house catering available. Maybe that also includes a cake. A lot of all-inclusive venues will even have a DJ and music setup and lighting services. So I know with that, you lose some of the opportunity to be really personalized and to maybe hire the exact dream team of vendors who you would ideally want to work with. But trust me when I say that being patient and looking for the right opportunity with an all-inclusive venue or as close to all-inclusive as you can get is going to be a huge time, money, and stress saver for you over the next few months. And to take that back a step, if you can't find an all-inclusive venue in that area, if that is just not in the cards, then here are some other ways that you can hire as few vendors as possible. For example, you could hire a DJ who also does the event lighting and he offers a photo booth as a package. That would be a great choice as opposed to hiring someone to design your lighting and your dance floor and play your music and make your announcements and a photo booth. I mean, we've gone from like four or five vendors down to one if you can find one person who can kind of offer all of those things. Another example would be a florist slash event designer. So someone who's going to do all the centerpieces, all the bouquets, all the boutonnieres, and they're going to design the table settings and provide the linens and the serving dishes and all of those extra decor items. That's going to make a ton less work and logistics for you as opposed to hiring a florist, an event designer, renting all the serving pieces and the linens and everything else. See if you can find one person to kind of take care of a bunch of different things for you. It's really going to be a stress saver in the end. And our last item to cover on long distance wedding planning is how to decide what warrants a trip from your current location to the wedding location. You're absolutely going to have to stay really organized and make really strategic trips for the top wedding priorities that you identify. Now, this is going to depend a lot on distance. So are we planning from San Diego to Los Angeles, which is just a couple hour drive, or are we planning from San Diego to a European country, which is clearly an entirely different ballgame? So make a list to get yourself organized of your top priority items that you really want to choose or check in person. And then we're going to lump those all together and see if we can group those into one or maybe two trips, more if it's closer, maybe just one if it's somewhere really far away. Now, what should those priorities look like? That's going to be a personal decision that you and your fiance can determine. Some top really important ones would be your venue. I think that's a pretty important thing to see and choose in person if possible. Depending on how much time off you have, how much resources you have to be traveling back and forth, some of the other smaller details might need to be delegated to that team of friends and or family who you have identified to help you out, or a wedding planner if you've hired a wedding planner. So again, for example, flying from New York City to Los Angeles just to do a cake tasting probably isn't practical for most of us. However, if you could lump the cake tasting together with choosing a caterer, meeting with a florist, sitting down in person with your wedding planner to do a check-in meeting, making an on-site visit to your venue, and doing a hair and makeup trial all in one long weekend trip, then that would make a lot more sense. Coming up after a quick break, we're going to review long-distance bridal shower tips and more of your questions from the past week. Today's show is brought to you by our friends at Newspaper Club. Newspaper Club has been helping people print their own newspapers since 2009 and gives you a really fun alternative to traditional wedding stationery. One of the top questions I get from you is asking for creative ideas and ways to personalize your wedding, and Newspaper Club is hands down one of my favorite personal touches. Designing your own newspaper and sending it as a save the date, a wedding invitation, or using it as a wedding day program is a really creative way to express your personalities and add a really individual touch to the day. Newspaper Club has printed more than 12 million newspapers for thousands of customers all over the world. And with flexible print runs starting at just one copy, it's perfect for any size wedding. You can choose from lots of free templates, and there's absolutely no design experience required to create an unforgettable wedding keepsake for you and your guests. You can enjoy easy online ordering and order free samples at newspaperclub.com. You'll get 20% off your order, up to a $100 discount, with promo code WEDDING. Julie and Brian from New York City share, guests absolutely loved the newspaper invitation and brought it with them to the wedding because of all the destination guidance. Many actually kept them long after the wedding as a keepsake, which was particularly touching. That website again is newspaperclub.com to order free samples and get 20% off your order, up to a $100 discount with promo code WEDDING. It's getting to be wedding band shopping time, and you can enjoy the same top materials and quality craftsmanship as the most luxurious jewelry brands without the traditional markups by shopping with Noemi. I love that Noemi uses sustainably sourced diamonds and gold to offer you quality wedding bands that are guaranteed to be better priced than anywhere else in the world. They've partnered with a production house based in Los Angeles since 1979, featuring a team of craftsmen that have been making fine jewelry for decades. Noemi uses solid, reclaimed gold and the option to order with natural conflict-free stones or man-made lab-grown diamonds on some styles. The result? Quality wedding bands that are guaranteed to be better priced than anywhere else. Noemi also makes buying fine jewelry so easy. Enjoy free overnight shipping so that you can select a ring, try it on, and if it's not exactly what you're looking for, you have 60 days to return it for free for a full refund. Your Noemi jewelry is made to last a lifetime and one day become a family heirloom. I'm so impressed by the quality of my own Noemi diamond band. It is sparkly, it's dainty, and I get a ton of compliments on it. The icing on the cake is that your shopping experience with Noemi is completely risk-free. Enjoy a lifetime warranty, free overnight shipping, and free returns for a full refund. Head to hellonoemi.com and use the promo code WEDDING for $75 off any wedding band. You'll find lots of beautiful options for wedding bands at the highest quality and lowest price anywhere. That website again is hellonoemi.com with promo code WEDDING for $75 off any wedding band. And I'll put a link to that in the show notes as well. Back to the show. Okay, let's get back into your questions. And the first one is going to carry on the theme of long distance planning. This one is on bridal showers. So if you are traveling to another state for your bridal shower, it's safe to assume that you probably are not going to be able to carry a bunch of big, heavy appliances and larger gifts home on the airplane. That's not practical. It's also not practical to hire a U-Haul to carry a ton of appliances and larger items. So the question from our listener is how to handle that, because she knows that her family and friends would be saddened by just giving cash or a gift card and would want to give her a larger, more personal gift from the registry. So an easy solution for this is I would suggest providing your home address as the ship-to address on your registry and having guests ship those larger items straight to your home address. And I know it takes a little bit of the fun out of wrapping a gift and presenting it in person and watching someone open it in person. But again, it's just not practical to load up a suitcase with a ton of big, clunky items that would much easier just be shipped directly to your home. And a tactful way of asking guests to ship the item, let a sister, your mom, your aunt, let someone know that that's what's going on, because as obvious as it might seem, people don't always consider the fact that you will have to travel with these gifts. Sometimes showers can be up to 100 plus people. That is a lot of generosity and a lot of things that you would then be stuck getting back to your home. And again, people don't always think about that when they're purchasing. So if you can kind of have someone close to you spread the word that you would prefer to have the gifts shipped, I know it's kind of awkward to spell it out and there's not really a nice or a tactful way of saying, don't bring a gift to the shower, send it to my house. So have a couple of messengers kind of spread the word for you, and that will usually do the trick. And that question wraps up our focus on long distance planning. We're going to move into a few other questions that came in via Instagram last week. If you would like to participate in future Q&As, just follow Wedding Planning Podcast on Instagram and keep an eye out for question prompts that I drop a couple times a week. And this question is on how to handle the ceremony and the toasts at the reception when you have an audience of bilingual guests. So a couple of options here. The first one is you could have a translator touch on the most important points. They don't need to rehash word by word by word so that you're literally doubling the length of everything. But especially for the ceremony, if you wanted to have someone translating the highlights, the most important points, that would be an option for you. Another option would be, so for example, in the ceremony, choose one reading per language or alternate languages throughout the readings. So if you had four readings or four elements to the ceremony, you could split them, do two in one language, two in the other language. I know that that means that half the guests are going to miss half the things, but love is really a universal language. So know that while not everyone will understand every single word, the emotion and the feeling behind it, that will be communicated. And I don't think you want to, again, double the length of it by having every single word recited in each language. So a hybrid of this is a really nice way of doing that. And it's also a really symbolic kind of nice gesture of the two of you, you and your now husband or wife, becoming one person and bringing your families together as one and kind of everyone accepting and acknowledging that although there may be language barriers and there may be differences in culture and background, that now the two of you are coming together as one family. And last point here, if it's possible to print your wedding programs, signs, menus in both languages, that is a really nice gesture. There are a ton of really inexpensive and or free downloadable templates for all of the wedding stationery that you can just type in and print at home. So it by no means needs to become an expensive project that's going to bust your budget. But if you can sneak both languages into the programs and the things that your guests are going to be looking at throughout the wedding experience, that's always a really nice and accommodating gesture. And I'll repeat just one more time, really trust that love is a universal language. So even if everyone doesn't literally understand every single word being spoken, that feeling will be there. So I hope that's helpful. Next question is, my wedding is 1 year away. Is it too early to start buying decorations? This is a really, really good question, and it's gonna depend really heavily on your kind of decision-making personality and also a couple of other logistic things. If you are a really decisive person and you are known for just knowing exactly what you want, there's not a ton of debate in your head, then I think it's safe to purchase some of the decor items a year ahead of time, especially if you have a really firm handle on the color scheme, your venue is booked, so you have a vision of what that's all going to look like. I think that's fine. However, if you are more of an indecisive person who's prone to changing your mind, then I would probably hold off on purchasing decoration elements until you get a little bit closer to the day. And same thing goes if you have not selected or committed to a venue or a color scheme. Again, probably best to wait until you get a little bit closer, just because those things can change. You can be really tied to one vision at the very beginning of your engagement. And trust me, that can definitely evolve over 6 months or so to where you land in a totally different vision than what you had originally had. So I hope that's helpful. It really depends on your personality and decision-making style, and also just where you are in the wedding plans in terms of having color scheme and venue kind of locked in. And your last wonderful question for today that I'm going to share is, how should we handle the dress code for the wedding? Dress code is a good hot topic, and for simplicity's sake, I personally think that people really only get the following dress code guidelines: casual, dressy casual, formal, and black tie. I would say that most weddings hover in the dressy casual to formal space, kind of somewhere in that realm, with certain guests leaning more to one side than others. So you will have guests who show up a little bit less formal than other guests. If it's really important to you that everyone follow a very specific dress code, then you need to make that very clear in very simple terms on your invitations. So it should be spelled out somewhere on that invite if you want people to adhere to a really strict dress code. Now, I will say here that I think there's more gray area in a dress code for women than there is for men. So when you say to wear a suit and a tie, and that qualifies as formal, for men, that's pretty straightforward. But to put on your invitation dresses only for the ladies, a dress can range from very casual, something I would wear to the grocery store or the beach, to something very formal. And it's really hard to get a big group of people from different areas of the country on the exact same page in terms of how they define formal, for example. So formal will probably mean something very different to your aunt from a really metropolitan area than it would to your cousin who lives on a farm. And I'm not generalizing or making fun of anyone from a metropolitan area or on a farm. I'm just pointing out that the reality that dress code nuances exist can really come down to regional places and where people are from. Now, in my experience, you typically get a bunch of your guests chattering back and forth on social media, on the phone, texting back and forth. You got big families talking, and they're chatting back and forth about who's wearing pants and a dressy top, or who's going to be wearing a skirt, or who bought a new dress and what does it look like. Is your husband going to wear a tie or no tie? Is he going to wear khakis or dark colored dress pants with a white button-up dress shirt? So depending on your crew, you might have to have some more flexible expectations. And with that, if you are particularly concerned about your uncle showing up in blue jeans, then I would suggest having a conversation with him or have someone else close to him pass along the word about what the wedding dress code means to you and gently tell him that jeans are not acceptable. And with that, let's wrap it up for this week. Great show. Thank you so very much for being here. To submit your wedding questions for future episodes, all you have to do is head over to Instagram and follow Wedding Planning Podcast. I'll put up question prompts a couple times a week. And last thing before I go, don't forget to send me a DM. The first 7 people who I hear from will get a Wedding Planning Podcast pink trucker hat. With summer coming up, it's a great thing to throw in your beach bag. All I need from you is to know your favorite episodes, your least favorite episodes, your name, and your mailing address. And the first 7 people will get one of those cute little hats in the mail from me. Thank you again for being here. I really look forward to hearing from you soon, and have a great day. Thank you so much for tuning in to today's episode of the Wedding Planning Podcast. For details on any links and resources mentioned in today's show, be sure to take a peek at the show notes on your mobile device. You can also head over to weddingplanningpodcast.co for a complete library of past episodes and to sign up for weekly show notes and resources delivered straight to you via email. Until next time, have a great day, happy planning, and I can't wait to chat again soon. Cheers!